Native people. Native culture. Native knowledge. Hi, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you award-winning Heartbeat Alaska.
Bringing you national and international Native news, this is award-winning Heartbeat Alaska, the premier Native voice in Native programming.
There's a heartbeat loud as thunder. Revolution is in the air. There's a heartbeat deep inside our mother. Are you too cool to care?
Now, with Heartbeat Alaska, here's Jeannie Green.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native News and Native Entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green. Thank you so much for joining us. On today's program, Gary Fife is back with us. Also, Eve Little from Taos, New Mexico, reports on the gaming situation in that area. We travel to rural Alaska, to Bethel, for the annual Rural Providers Conference. All that plus more villages across the North and Native America. Here's Gary now with Native News across the nation. I'll be back in just a moment, so don't go away.
This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife. The numbers of plaintiffs seem to approach the amount in the fund as criticism grows over the handling of millions of dollars that was supposed to be banked and invested on behalf of Native Americans across the nation. It's the Bureau of Indian Affairs' handling of Native funds held in individual accounts that's being called a disaster. The Indian Money's trust fund accounts are the proceeds of various rents and royalties from Native lands. In the latest report, the Native American Rights Fund and 300,000 account holders have filed suit against the Interior Department for mismanaging that fund for decades. When the International Summer Olympic Games begin this month in Atlanta, some other runners will be showing up, but not to compete. It'll be the conclusion of the Sacred Run, which began at the end of March and was scheduled to reach Atlanta on July 11th. Runners are not just Native Americans, and their declared purpose is to show that all life is sacred and the earth should be protected. The Macaw people of Northwest Washington State have lost their bid to reclaim an ancient tribal tradition of hunting whales. The tribe has been seeking approval and support from the federal government and the International Whaling Commission in their bid to hunt 5 gray whales. The tribe wants to renew the tradition for their young people, but the international body said no, and the U.S. government withdrew its support. The U.S. Bureau of Census says it's going to test a couple of new ways and try and get a more accurate account of the Native American population. The Census Bureau will conduct 2 tests in Idaho and in New Mexico to try and improve their accuracy. At the Fort Hall Shoshone-Bannock Reservation and the Laguna Pueblo, census workers will be trying out new lists, more user-friendly questionnaires, and trying to find a more convenient place to put them. A group of Christian church pastors who have registered their support for Apaches who oppose the Mount Graham project in Arizona have shown up in a rally. In recent weeks, the religious leaders from Tucson area churches attended spiritual rallies and a Holy Ground blessing ceremony. The meeting was to call more public attention to the San Carlos Apache people who say the telescope sits on a site held sacred by their tribe. Here's this week's conference note. Native American professionals working in various tribal Head Start programs in the Northwest U.S. will be getting together to share their information and ideas in August. The Northwest Indian Head Start Coalition will begin its 6th annual conference, August 6th, in Denver, Colorado. This year's conference is scheduled to be held in conjunction with the National Tribal Child Care Conference. For more information, contact the Fort Hall Reservation's Head Start program in Idaho. And finally, 3 students who showed their ethnic pride during high school graduation ceremonies in Muskogee, Oklahoma, were denied the chance to participate in those ceremonies this year. A Native American senior who added an eagle feather to the traditional mortarboard headgear, and 2 African American students who added African multicolored patterns to their gowns were denied their diplomas. School officials said their actions were a violation of the dress code and required the 3 students to attend summer school as punishment. We're interested in the news of your native group, your tribe, or we want to hear it about an event that you're participating in. Please drop us a line or give us a call here at our program. This is Native News Across the Nation. I'm Gary Fife, and back to Jeannie Green and more Heartbeat Alaska.
There's a heartbeat louder than thunder.
Thank you, Gary. In Taos, New Mexico, the gaming situation looks grave. Eve Little has the story.
It's the latest setback for about 13 casino tribes here in New Mexico. Just this week, U.S. District Court ruled against the tribe's right to have casino gambling operation.
This is the very latest in a continuing fight between the state of New Mexico and New Mexico casino tribes. It started about a year ago when New Mexico Governor Gary Johnson signed a gaming compact with 13 tribes, including 9 Indian Pueblos. The legislators and the state attorney general then challenged the compact before the state Supreme Court. The high court struck it down in favor of the attorney general. The casino tribes then sued in federal court, only to have U.S. Attorney John Conway upheld the Supreme Court's decision. And now this ruling seems to put the final nail on the coffin, although attorneys for the casinos have filed for a stay. And also an appeal is in the works to the 10th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals in Denver. As of now, all casinos are supposed to close down by July 27th. Here at Taos Pueblo, the casino is half finished. Tribal officials refuse to speak with us or let us go inside the business. But the word of mouth around here is that this Pueblo made a major investment into the casino, and all that may now be lost. In Taos, New Mexico, I'm Eve Little for Heartbeat Alaska.
I was just about to fix myself a drink when I happened to glance out the window. What I saw stopped me cold in my tracks. My kids were outside in the yard imitating me. They were playing drunk, staggering and falling down. It was then that I realized how my drinking was affecting my children. They were learning from me through my actions. I knew it wouldn't be easy, but I resolved then and there to get help. If you have a problem with alcohol, stop and think, ask yourself, what are you teaching your children?
This message brought to you by the Anchorage Service Unit members and NM Health Service.
Travel with me now to Bethel, Alaska for the annual Rural Providers Conference. This year's main subject, sobriety.
In the 60s, our excuse was that we work 8 hours a day. We provide for our children. That's my husband's and my excuse. When our daughter was 16, we got her a car. For our son, we'd get him a lot of bikes and mopeds. That was to comfort ourselves, to pacify ourselves while we were drinking.
Alcohol has been called the scourge of rural Alaska. This week, hundreds gathered in Bethel to come up with solutions to fight this lethal problem among Native people.
I didn't know how to end my alcoholism. I didn't know how. My daughter here, Priscilla, she used to ask me to go to AA with her. I went once, and what did I do? I thought I knew more than all of them together.
Stella Atkinson is a Tsimshian Indian from Southeast Alaska. She's an elder from the village of Metlakatla, and today a strong supporter of the Native sobriety movement. But at one time, she drank. That ended, and her life turned around when perfume and sunglasses couldn't hide the truth from her grandchild.
She took one look at me. She said, "Grandma, you're drunk." And that hurt. And that's when I made my turnaround. That's when I began my turnaround.
To see Stella Atkinson today, it seems hard to believe she once abused alcohol.
She's one of the many success stories at this year's conference, whose theme is We Are Teachers, Show Love. For health providers in Alaska, that love translates into patients. Patients with staggering statistics. According to a report by the Alaska State Department of Epidemiology, alcohol played a part in 801 deaths in the state for the years 1992 to 94. Patients with some outsiders who stereotype all natives as drunks, and patients with a repeat treatment resident who keeps coming back. Today's sobriety movement emphasizes turning around, looking at your village, seeing your ancestors, hearing their drums. You have not lost your most profound strength, the fact that you are Native.
There are a lot of weakened links, missing links in our culture. It's a big change. I don't speak my language, I don't do the dance, and so I'm a weakened link. And every time I learn something of my culture or your culture, I strengthen it up or I add the missing link so that we can reclaim our power.
Some of that power includes a changing philosophy of health providers. For instance, when a treatment resident comes back time after time, it's a sign of progress, not a failure. After all, there is hope, and hope is what feeds the spirit.
My mom talked about today is a great day, tomorrow's going to be even a better day. It's an honor to be alive. And there's a saying that one of my mentors said to me years ago, the Creator's gift to you is life. What you do with that life is your gift to the Creator. It's always a two-way street with our Creator, with each other, with our parents, with our elders.
Heritage. My ancestors were fishermen, craftsmen, and hunters whose beliefs and traditions live on today. Sometimes it's difficult to follow the ways of my people when there is so much influence from outside. My father says it's all right to keep up with the changing times, as long as I keep the knowledge of the past alive in my heart. Life is harmony between the past and present. My mother says being an Alaska Native is special. She always puts her arms around me, looks at me lovingly, and says, "Be proud to be you."
This message brought to you by the Anchorage Service Unit members and NM Health Service.
This year's Rural Providers Conference was co-sponsored by the Yukon-Kuskokwim Health Corporation and also by Rural Alaska Community Action Program. And thank you, Amy Chang and Ronna McBride, for making this story possible. Do you believe that life is abundant? Do you believe that you can accomplish anything? Well, I believe that about myself, but especially about you. And so does a gentleman named Howard Rainier. Here's a segment of a documentary called Indian Pride on the Move.
We cannot have a generation of Indian quitters. Why did we do that? Why did we teach these kids to say, we're going to make it, we're going to go to college, we're going to get through? Why? Because a lot of Indian kids do not what?
They don't know how,
they don't make it, they quit, right? Okay, they don't believe in themselves. So we're going to try to teach you this morning how to. Because we're Indian people today, C average is not good enough. We are people of genius, we are smart people. You going to go to college?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes.
Well, prove it to me. Come on. Come on. Push me through. Come on. There's one that made it right there. Okay.
You know what? If we can teach our young people to visualize what they want to be, it's the same way. I want to visualize graduating. I want to be in the Army. I want to be driving a jet. I want to be a pilot. I want to be an engineer. See, we have to visualize those things.
Dentist, Tony. Computer scientist, Wanton. Doctor, Squeaky.
He taught us not to quit and to keep on striving for what we're striving for.
And we need to, in this conference, go back and say, you will not quit, and I will not quit with you until we finish the job together. And I'll tell you, for every Indian young person you help to help themselves, that will be the new history for American Indians. When you see Indian young people believing in themselves and starting to turn their lives around.
Mentally, when we said we're going to do something, we can what?
Do it.
If we say we're going to be shy, we'll act it out. If we say we're smart, we will be smart. If we say we're lazy, we're lazy. If we say we're tired, we're tired. See, the mind is so powerful.
We are somebody.
We are somebody.
That's not good enough. We are somebody.
We are somebody.
What hurts me inside sometimes is to hear a young person say, I'm not good enough. I can't do it. To somebody else. Why me? And you know, when I see that, it just stirs something inside of me to shake those young people and say, why don't you catch the vision of yourself? What can I do to help you to see that inside of you has so much goodness inside, so much ability in your mind? Louder.
We have good minds.
Okay, one more time, loud.
We have good minds.
We are somebody.
We are somebody.
Now say it like you mean it.
Ready? Here we go.
We are somebody. We have good mind. We're going somewhere.
When I say I have a good mind, when I say I'm somebody, when I say I can do great things, I will. I will. When I say I am somebody, that's right. And when I say I'm smart, I am. And when I say I'm going places, that's where I'm going. Don't fear who you are. Use your best talents. Use your creativity. Use the talents that God gave you, and you will not fail.
Now, what if we started to teach our young people to look people in the eye? When they go to college, when they look for a job, what would it do for them? It helped them. It would help them. See, a lot of young kids, they're articulate, they're smart, but what happens? They put a hand out and it's macaroni, right? And they lose it. We're trying to teach our young people to look people in the eye and talk to them. Now, some traditions say that's taboo, some say that's disrespectful, but hey, when you're out there in Albuquerque or Los Angeles or San Diego, they don't say, hey, that's disrespectful. They say, look at me. You see? Teach your young people to look people as they're talking.
I try to stress the importance of these Indian young people of staring people in the eye. Looking people in the eye with confidence. Burn into their eyes that you are somebody, that you have something to offer, that you are somebody of self-worth. If we can look people in the eye and express ourselves and stand with manly dignity, then people will start to recognize us. And I think that's an important principle to learn with these young people. They need to learn that, first of all, they are somebody to be reckoned with, that they have something to offer.
Watch what happens the next time you meet a person and you do that. Hi, my name is Harvey. Really happy to meet you. Look at that. Look. See? You know what? They'll never forget you. You want to be forgotten? Just try doing this. I was in Sal Rudy. You're forgotten. You do this, and you go to school and say, hi, my name is Sal Rudy, glad to meet you. They'll never forget you. You know why? They took a mental picture of you. Because many people would like to say the Indian is stoic. I don't believe that. I don't believe this generation of Indian people was meant to be silent. I think we were meant to stand in the front. I think we were meant to have a purpose. I think we were meant to be in the front. And that's what I want to teach Indian people, to stand, to speak, to stand up for something that's right, to speak for themselves, and to be able to express all those things that are inside their heart. So people will know we're here. We have something to offer. And friends, listen to friends. They're more apt to listen to a person that cares for them than a person that doesn't care for them. So teachers and counselors and educators, you've got to be friends with the people that you're working with. They'll see right through it. There's a great lesson in this, to teach the young people that you want to be a friend. And if you don't want to be a friend, you're in the wrong business. You're in the wrong school. When I was in South Dakota, the greatest thing I saw was a 12-year-old boy who said, let's build a playground, a good playground, with plenty of sand and plenty of things to do for the kids. And I said, why don't you draw that playground and let's take it over to the tribal council. And you know what he did? He took it over to the tribal council, and guess what they did? There goes his dream. And that's the way it is. You know, we have all these youth leadership conferences, and the Indian leaders say, good, go do it, go do it. But we don't want to get involved. We don't know how to work with teenagers. And I say to myself, you know, if you were there and you put your arm around those kids and you say, hey, we need you and we want you, maybe then we'll have some future tribal leaders. Indians were not meant to quit. Indians were meant to rise up. Indians were meant to lead. Indians were meant to be in first place. Indians were meant to be in the halls of justice. Indians were meant to stand. Indians were meant to have a divine destiny. And that's what keeps me going. Because I know if God promised it, and I know if our Indian people were promised that, I know it will be fulfilled. And there is no Indian or anybody that can tell me that it is not going to happen. Because you're going to make it happen. And these kids are going to make it happen. And someday we will see great things on the horizons. God bless each one of you, that you will have the courage to catch the vision, to change things around, to make Indian people count, and to put them in the forefront, and to put them in the light where they should be.
We bring Native news to the world. Join us as we report news from a Native perspective. Heartbeat Alaska is the Native news source for America. We welcome you to be a reporter. Call us today and we'll train you. Join the team.
Hello, welcome to Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. I'm Jeannie Green.
This is Native news across the nation. I'm Gary Fife.
Hello, Heartbeat Alaska from way down south, Winter Rock, Arizona.
For Heartbeat Alaska and SKC Public TV, this is Annette Brown.
For Heartbeat, I'm Eve Little in Taos, New Mexico. There's a heartbeat, loud as thunder.
There's a heartbeat coming up from deep down. Thank you once again for joining us here at Heartbeat Alaska, Native news and Native entertainment. We have some exciting news. We formed a nonprofit organization called One Sky International Productions Incorporated. It was formed to train Native Americans in broadcast journalism and also formed so that we may make movies from a Native perspective, movies made by Natives about Natives. If you'd like to donate to One Sky International Productions Incorporated, contact us here at Heartbeat Alaska. The address will be at the top of the credits. But most importantly, I've been reading the papers lately. There are so many Native events happening across Canada, in the lower 48, and Alaska. If you're attending one of these events, take your camcorder along and share the news with us. We appreciate that. For all of us here, I'm Jeannie Green, bringing you Native news. Please join us again next week. We'll see you then.
seahorse was a mystic. He knew the secret of a trance. And Sitting Bull, the great apostle of the ghost dance.